Hello and happy Father's Day. I'm Daniel Maté and welcome to Lyrics to Go. And this is my Father's Day episode with my dad, Dr. Gabor Maté. For those of you who are new to Lyrics to Go, it is a channel devoted entirely to the craft and art of song lyrics. I'm a professional lyricist myself for musical theater, but I'm a fan of basically every popular genre you can name. And I'm one of these people who really remembers the lyrics. I've always really listened to them. And what I'm trying to do with this channel is eliminate the phrase, "Oh, you know, I don't really listen to the words," from the face of the earth, because I think listening to lyrics adds a completely other dimension to enjoying all kinds of music, even silly music. So that's what I'm all about here. There are tons of videos already up. You can check out videos about bands from Joni Mitchell to Steely Dan to Bob Dylan to Metallica to Talking Heads to Run DMC. And I'm going to be doing a whole bunch more coming up. So like I said, if you subscribe below, that's your best way to stay in the loop. And whenever I release a video, if you click the bell, you will get notified. This is part one of my conversation with my dad. If you want to see part two, which is just as great, you can head on over to patreon.com/lyrics2go. And that's my subscription only page, where you can subscribe for a very, very low price per month and get all kinds of benefits, including custom playlists for every episode and bonus content, such as part two of this conversation. So I hope you'll check that out. And either way, thank you for watching and supporting the channel. Okay, here we go. Happy Father's Day, everyone. Enjoy the conversation.
Whoa, Daddy.
All right, welcome back to Lyrics to Go. I am Daniel Maté, and today I have a very special guest for this Father's Day. He is a best-selling author, speaker, therapist in demand. He is a physician, retired physician. He is my collaborator on a couple of books and several workshops that we've led together. And he also is my father. It's Gabor Maté. Welcome to Lyrics to Go, Dad.
Nice to be here with you, Daniel.
Yeah. Happy Day of the Father to you.
Thank you, oh my son.
Are you into fathers? You've never struck me as like the kind of father who's like expecting or even...
No, I'm not much into these contrived commemorations of the obvious. So no, I'm not. I've never been into Father's Day. No.
What does it say to you that we need a day to honor the obvious?
Well, it means that if there was daily honoring, if there's regular honoring of the generations by one the other, we wouldn't have to have special days.
Right.
You know, and. You know, the Bible says, honor thy father and thy mother. And that's an interesting lyric to parse, by the way. Fact is, it often doesn't happen. And so then we have these sentimental days that sell a lot of cards and maybe gifts and give people a chance to feel good about themselves. But what if actually honoring was just part of how we lived our lives? I'm not preaching as any kind of a practitioner of the honoring.
This isn't a passive aggressive message for me.
No, it's not. I'm not passive aggressive because you know, honoring has to go in all directions.
Right. Yeah.
And you know, my friend Rafi's got this concept, an institute for honoring.
Child honoring, right.
Yeah.
I guess honoring is something that's bred in the bone. If you grow up in a context in which honoring is a skill, then honoring your father and mother is not something you need to remember to do. It's not a behavior. It's not an event you don't have to make a date to do it. It's just something you're skilled at doing and you naturally would do.
Yeah. I wouldn't even call it a skill because that implies some kind of a learned ability to do something. It's more like a natural outcome of a healthy relationship.
Right. That's right. And a healthy culture, which holds relationships in an honorable way.
In a healthy tradition. That's right.
Yeah. Yeah. Well,
So
like it or not, that, like it or not, you moved to North America, and in North America, we have corny Hallmark days like Father's Day.
Yeah.
And one of the things that people have done with Father's Day a lot is write a lot of songs, or not just for Father's Day, but around this time, you know, these songs start to get a lot of play. And I thought it might be fun and interesting to look at some of these Father's Day songs with you and just see what they bring up and see what kind of conversation we can have stemming from it.
See what kind of scorn we can pour on them.
Maybe. Or you know, honestly, I was listening to one of them earlier that I didn't know. I'm not going to tell you which one.
Okay.
I was walking down the street weeping.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, well, that'll be... Well, I look forward to that.
Yeah, I'm not going to tell you which. I'm not going to tell you which, and I can't promise I'm going to repeat it, the performance, but...
Yeah. But I will rein in my cynical impulses here.
No, but hey, your cynical impulses are welcome. Let's just see if we can awaken any others.
Very good.
Well, why don't we start with one that is pretty standard. I know you know it. Cats in the Cradle, originally by Harry Chapin. I thought I would play you the Johnny Cash version, since Johnny Cash is, of course, one of your gurus.
Of course he is.
All right. So let's check out Cats in the Cradle.
My son turned 10 just the other day. He said, thanks for the ball, Dad. Come on, let's play. Can you teach me to throw? I said, not today. I got a lot to do. He said, that's okay. And he walked away, but his smile never did. It said, I'm gonna be like him, yeah. You know I'm gonna be like him. And the cat's in the cradle and the silver spoon.
Yeah, what I got to say is, ouch. It's just too close to home. I mean, I was one of these dads, as you know. Not that I'd have spent no time with my kids, but too often the external concerns of job, career, and just whatever my own obsessions and interests were displaced, the fathering instinct. And I, one of my worst memories, you know, is being with your brother, Aaron, in the snow near a park, and I get a beep to go to the hospital, but a delivery at the hospital. And I so badly wanted to spend time with him. And I even knew that I could wait to go to the hospital, but I just left. Mm-hmm. And that's one of many such examples. And so that song, it brings up pain for me. You know, I mean, it's healthy pain. But if I had to do life over again, I would do it differently.
Okay, I got it. So let's listen to another song that looks at a similar, and I think a lot of parents feel the same way you do, you know, or they have these moments, and
a lot of parents.
How do you navigate the difference between what you called healthy pain or healthy regret and crippling guilt?
Healthy remorse versus guilt.
Yeah. What's the line for you?
It's a difficult line, but healthy regret, healthy remorse, it's expressed, but it doesn't eat away at you. It's just a recognition that, that could have been different. And I'm the one that was there that could have made a difference had I been more conscious. Mm-hmm. Guilt is a deeper dynamic that eats away at you and doesn't really let go. Doesn't matter how many times you express it. And it really has nothing to do with usually the subject that you think you feel guilty about, or it's only tangentially related.
It's a pre-existing condition
that then feeds on itself in a sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for me, when I feel guilt that feels healthy, it feels like I'm metabolizing something.
Yeah.
And one of the things I'm metabolizing is cause and effect and consequence and the reality that life is finite and I only get one and that I'm going to die. I mean, ultimately, that's what it comes down to, because if I wasn't going to die, then I could just, you know, you could just have a bunch more kids and do it different. Like if we had forever, then our fuck ups wouldn't be such a big deal. But when there's a healthy guilt, it actually kind of wakes me up to, oh, wow, am interested in living a life I can look back on and not having any more of these regrets.
Yeah. Yeah. By the way, I don't know how to say this delicately, but for me to have more kids, I'd have to, number one, reverse my vasectomy, and number two, marry a younger woman, you know, than your postmenopausal mother. So I'm not sure how I'm going to do that one.
Well, I know a guy. I don't know. So I can help you with one half of it. I know a guy. I'm here in Mexico. He's reliable. He's clean.
Yeah. Okay.
And he's a lot cheaper than anything you'll find back home.
I'll think about it.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'll have to discuss it with your mother about how she might feel about me marrying somebody much younger, but.
Well, she does. She wants grandkids. Maybe stepkids would be the next best thing.
It's a conversation we could have, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's great. Hey, Mom, come in here. live on Lyrics to Go. Gabor and Ray get divorced. All right, let's play you another song. And this is by a country artist named Brad Paisley, who I hadn't heard of before. And the song is called Anything Like Me. And I think in some ways it's a flip side of the song we just heard.
He'll probably stay out too late and drive his car too fast. Get a speeding ticket and he'll pay for mowing grass. He's gonna get caught skipping class and be grounded for a week. He's gonna get in trouble, we're gonna get in fights. I'm gonna lose my temper and some sleep. It's safe to say that I'm gonna get my payback if he's anything like me.
So this is the song that had me crying.
Really? That's interesting. I have I find it sentimental and sentimental.
Oh, it absolutely is.
Sentimental things can make me cry too, but I wonder how real that is. I mean, it's kind of a romanticization, or kind of a good old macho boy who is at the same time having to hide his vulnerability. Like, why can't he hug his dad as he leaves? And why does he have to cry privately? You know, I mean, that bespeaks the whole kind of programming and acculturation to be different on the outside than on the inside, you know?
Absolutely.
There's nothing about the boy reading books or appreciating art. It's all about the usual macho male pursuits, you know?
Here's the thing. As I listen to this kind of music, just as I listen to any kind of lyric or music, what I choose to do in order to be able to get the most out of it is to place it in context. And it comes from a certain, you can pretend it comes from a certain planet, culture. Yeah. Now, that planet is governed by a music industry that pulls for sentimental cliche and a whole bunch of retrograde stereotypes and all that. But within that, there's a lot of heart.
Yeah, it's true.
And there always has been a lot of heart. In fact, in some ways, a lot more heart than in the, you know, Brill Building or LA or, you know, New York worlds of songwriting. In some ways, it's a lot less cynical. There may be some politically backward things in terms of gender roles and all that. So I just, first of all, have to check my coastal elite snobbery at the door, number one. Number two, remember that people are doing their best within a culture.
Yeah.
And so if he's into, like, I wasn't into Tonka trucks, but you know, not everyone's into reading Proust. They're not. No, believe it or not. But I was thinking, like, in the second verse, if you were writing this song, instead of, you know, I can see him right now, knees all skinned up with a magnifying glass trying to melt a Tonka truck. Won't he be a sight with his football helmet on? That'll be his first love till his first love comes along. You know, your version would be something like, I can see him right now, you know, flying all over the country, giving 6 talks in 3 days, you know, rushing off to deliver babies at the drop of a hat.
No. In his childhood, you would have seen him hunched over a book or.
Okay. Yeah. So, yeah, exactly. So let's hear your version.
Well, I don't know. It doesn't matter, but I get it. Yeah. So I give it the heart, you know, and country music certainly has heart.
Yeah.
And by and large, unless it starts getting so maudlinly patriotic and so on.
Oh, sure.
It's there's nothing cynical about it. And there's nothing jaded about it.
There's nothing jaded, and there's something. And look, as the lyricist here, I just need to shout out the craft here. It's extremely well crafted.
Okay.
Even just little, you know, a verse, a pre-chorus, and a chorus that takes real thought, and even just little rhymes like "It's safe to say that I'm gonna get my payback." That double rhyme. He does the same thing at the end. As he drives out, he'll cry his eyes out. I mean, that kind of stuff gets me. Those attentions to detail, I find them so loving, especially when they're done intelligently. He's going to hug his mama. He's going to shake my hand because, you know, that's where we're from. That's just how we act around here. But what I found, so that's right around the time I started leaking a little bit. Just because and the bridge does what a good bridge should do. It complicates the story. Up until now, it's been pretty superficial, I agree. And I was kind of rolling my eyes. Tonka trucks and, well, you know, he's probably going to be a kind of a roughhouser. He's going to probably get in trouble. But then he's going to love me and hate me along the way.
Yeah.
He's going to love me and hate me along the way.
That, like, already, like, that actually gets me, because that's the realization that this father's having, that I loved and hated my father, and this little, you know, not even yet here human being is going to have that complicated relationship with me, and then he's going to act like he can't wait to leave, but as he drives out, he'll cry his eyes out. Now, I'm not a father, but I am a son, and there's something about that ability to capture the mixed feelings that come with these relationships.
I can tell you that. I can tell you that when you guys became adults, I always felt so sad driving to the airport as you and your siblings are about to fly off to live far away from us, you know. And there was just I understand exactly what he's saying.
Yeah, and I didn't. I was always looking forward to getting on that plane, but I remember the. I cried myself to sleep my first night at McGill in Montreal because I just, even though I knew my place was no longer at home, I felt very out of place there.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I was extremely homesick that entire year, you know? So I love songwriters who can convey mixed feelings, because that to me is the spice of life. That's really what life is like for me.
Yeah. Fair enough.
And I wanted to play this song for you too, because of the last line.
Worst folks to be like, oh, he'll be all right if he's anything like me.
There's worse folks to be like.
Yeah. Well,
you know, so all of this self-castigation about, you know, so on and so forth, like.
And that's true. And you know, the other side of it is that for all that health of remorse, I couldn't be prouder of my kids, and I couldn't be more amazed at how they each turned out to be the wonderful human beings and manifestations of intelligence and love that they all turned out to be.
Well, on behalf of the other two, thank you. And we get it from somewhere, you know, and you know me, I've gotten a lot of mileage on my grievances.
You sure have. You've milked it.
Dear mother, dear father, what is this hell you have put me through? Believer, deceiver, day in, day out, live my life through you.
I've milked it. You handed me the bottle of milk in some ways, but
nothing.
You handed me the udder. You were like, here's the cow.
There's no more, this cow got no more lactation capacity left. It's been milked dry.
This cow's run dry, yeah.
Well, this is a good song for you.
Well, it'll be due to the tune of This Wheel's on Fire.
Okay.
But so a song like this also wakes me up to, wait a minute, hold on. No, like the stuff that hurts so much because of the love.
Exactly.
You know, and when I look back on my childhood recently, like when you were on Russell Brand, for instance, recently talking to him about Israel and Palestine, there's a particular way you have when you talk about that subject that you've always had, although it used to be a little bit more scornful. I think it used to get mixed up with some rage, understandably. And so I was always afraid, kind of in fear of that part, but the rest of it was just awe and love. I worshiped you when you were, going out there and speaking the truth, your truth, speaking up for justice in the face of just what was clear to me was just insanity, insane hate and fear. That is emblematic to me of something I remember from my childhood a lot, which is just adoring you and who you were in the world, and not just who you were in the world. Like there was a lot of times at home when you were just the ultimate to me, like we would play and, you know, so it's actually been nice in the past year or so. Now that we've gotten through a few cycles of this Hello Again workshop and I can get my grievances out there and they're up on YouTube and, I've gotten validation and or, finger wagging from hundreds of thousands of people for it.
I like Gabor, but Daniel seems less authentic to me somehow. It may be a personality thing, but he's not as sincere or concerned about people as Gabor. Wow. When you get into this video and really enlist and pay attention, you see profoundly toxic narcissism in the father, Gabor.
To get clear of that stuff so I can actually start to appreciate how much there is to appreciate, which is a ton. So I just want you to know that you don't have to carry that, like that's your legacy of like,
well, what a wonderful, your kids up. What a wonderful Father's Day gift. Thank you.
You're welcome. You're welcome. Should we listen to something else?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, that does it for part one, but the conversation is far from over. In part two, Gabor and I, my dad and I guess I alternate between those two, we listen to and talk about a couple of other songs, very different from these two and very different from each other. One is from a musical, the Tony Award-winning show Fun Home, which is one of my favorites, and it's a song about a daughter desperately trying to understand and get through to and have an honest conversation with her dad for the first time. And the second song is Papa Was a Rolling Stone. We don't listen to the Temptations version. There's an original version I didn't even know about. So you can tune in to find out about that. And then Gabor's comments on that song I found really insightful and fascinating.
But with any psychological insight, though, a really interesting question comes up. Because when you think of a Rolling Stone, mm-hmm. It doesn't have any internal momentum, does it?
No.
Something has to set it rolling. Mm-hmm. And so it sets a whole lot of questions about what happened to make that man course through his life like that, you know?
Yeah, what about his life tilted the slope in that particular direction? And then we got into a conversation finally about, you know, for people who have a hard time on days like Father's Day because their own memories of having a father are either kind of a blank or a very painful set of memories. Dad found, I think, a really interesting way of framing this idea of honoring your father and mother that doesn't require whitewashing the past, that doesn't require ignoring your own experience, but that can actually be a life-enhancing thing. And that was a really cool discussion as well. So that's in part two, which is available to my Patreon subscribers, like I said at the beginning. If you go to patreon.com/lyricstogo, That's where you can sign up to be a subscriber, and at the $5 a month level, you get access to all content, including bonus episodes like part two of this interview. So I hope you'll check that out, and I hope you'll subscribe to the channel below. It's free here on YouTube, and get notifications and keep coming back. Last thing to leave you with is that on Monday nights, if you're watching this on Father's Day, starting tomorrow night, I'll be doing a weekly live stream every week about a different topic or a different band. Last week, we talked about Talking Heads. This week, I haven't decided yet, but by the time you're watching this, I will have. So I hope you will subscribe and find out about that and join me live for some lyric appreciation.
No. We'll do it live! Fuck it!
All right. Happy Father's Day, everybody. Until next time, I'm Daniel Maté saying, I've got lyrics to go, and so does my dad. And now you do too.
But he's gonna love me and hate me along the way. The years are gonna fly by. Well, I already dread the day. He's gonna hug his mama. He's gonna shake my hand. He's gonna act like he can't wait to leave. And as he drives out, he'll cry his eyes out if he's anything like me. There's worse folks to be like. Oh, he'll be all right if he's anything.